to do something great and you want to be great, you should apply to JCIB.
You should apply to JCIB.
Should apply to come here.
I think you should apply to come here.
You should apply to JCIB.
And everybody saw these and got one of these over here.
Are you on the Y chart right now? otherwise, that'd be really fun for the people at home.
Oh, I know.
See you asleep.
We're there. I apologize for being late. It's just there's so much going on out there that, and we don't have a sign. We always forget a sign, which we shouldn't keep doing that. But welcome. I'm Lori Lightsey. I'm a principal at JCIB. And Mr. Cloninger, do the picture thing so they can see, is out front. I left him because we knew we could tell you guys when we see you. We said, that's JCIB people coming right there. So he's waiting on them. But to my right is Dr. Miller. She is the DP coordinator. She handles really everything at Shades Valley campus in Iredale, but more specifically, the 11th and 12th grade. This is Lauren Brown. She's the MYP, middle years program coordinator, and she goes between both campuses. She's at Pleasant Grove 6 through 8, and she also goes over and handles 9 and 10 at the high school campus. And Mr. Clonger will be in just a minute, and he is the assistant principal. Yeah, sit low if you need to. So we appreciate you being here, and we will honor your time. We'll go through this, and we'll be done in an hour and hopefully have time for questions at the end within that time. I don't usually read screens, but we need to read this one. This is very important because it really speaks to why we are and who we are and what we want to do with children. So the mission of JCIB is to cultivate intellectually curious, internationally minded individuals who possess the skills, knowledge, and creativity to positively impact lives through compassion and tolerance in an ever-changing world. That's a lot of words. But basically, we know we need super smart kids to come to us because our curriculum is rigorous, and it moves at a fast pace. So you have to have a student who's comfortable in an academic setting and enjoys work, enjoys school. That's a necessity. But we also want to have students come to us and understand that it's not just about being smart. There's more to life than just being smart. We want them to understand that we need to make a difference in the world around us, locally, nationally, and then internationally. We want kids thinking big. We want them to start small with ideas, but then stretch and think big about the impact that each human can actually have on the world around them. We also just want them to be really good people. We want them to understand, and we expect that they are tolerant, that they understand that we're not all the same. We don't all believe the same things. but that we can be respectful of one another in those different beliefs. That's an expectation. And we teach these things through the IB learner profile traits. These aren't just words on a wall. These are at the core of what we do, what we expect, and the things that we as adults continue to work on ourselves, because we know that if you have these 10 qualities, you're going to be in pretty good shape in the corporate world, in the academic world, and just the world in general. So when we say that we want IB learners to strive to be inquirers, to be knowledgeable, to be a thinker, to communicate, be a communicator, to be principled and open-minded, to be caring, take risks, be balanced and reflective, this is taught. It's not just stuck on the wall. We talk about these things. If I have discipline, which I don't have a lot of discipline problems, kids are kids though, so we still have conversations often. But if I have a student that I'm needing to work with on something, we're going to reference one of these. I'm going to reference the one that, you know, it looks like we need to think about this, or it looks like you've got this covered. You know, you're caring for sure, but are you really thinking about what you're doing? We're gonna use these things, and that makes them real, makes them more valuable, and the students can then transfer it to other areas of their life. They take it with them. So this is who we are. And these other people have all kind of good information that they're going to share with you after this. Clicky, clicky. Ah, she likes Zoom.
Sydney?
One day I'm going to do this part.
One day. I'll be absent one day. Okay, so we do a lot of testing. We do a lot of reading, a lot of writing, and so we thought we'd go ahead and get started right now on a quiz. So I'm going to read the questions, and if you'll just think about your answers, and then we'll talk about them. So the first question is, what food is most commonly consumed by teenagers? Who's got an idea? Yes?
Pizza.
Pizza, okay.
Chick-fil-A.
Chick-fil-A, okay. Any other ideas? All right, we'll let those two go. Second question. How many television sets are in the average household? Four. Everything. Two. Four.
Three.
Okay. And the final question, at what age does the average individual acquire an automobile?
16.
15. 17. 22. Okay. All right. Nice wide assortment of answers in all of those. How did you come up with those answers? Yes, ma'am.
Mine is based off of, I have a 22-year-old stepmother.
Uh-huh.
And I have a 15-year-old stepmother. She just made it to ninth grade. She worked hard. And when he was in school, his favorite thing was he had to have a chicken leg. And I'm like, dude, you can't do that.
So we're talking about personal experience. All right? Good answers. All of those were good answers. They were not the right answers, but they were good answers, so that's okay. So the answer to the most commonly consumed food by teenagers, rice. Okay, the average number of television sets in a household, 0. And the age at which most people acquire an automobile, they never do.
0.
There we go. Okay, so if we think about it, what makes it different is that this is a global context. This is a bigger picture. This is what we'd like to do in IB. One is the trick, and two is to think in big picture, not just based on our experience. Our experience is important, but you also want to be able to go beyond that and say, you know, what is going on outside of my neighborhood? What is going on in the world as a whole? At the core of IB is this idea of international mindedness, and this is just a very simplistic version of that. But we're not an island. We have to depend on each other. We have to think about more than just ourselves. And so this is one way to get started with that. I don't think that's me anymore. Yeah. So that's the, there we go.
I've had control of the situation. Good evening to y'all. Ms. Lacy probably introduced me when I was not in here, but I'm Michael Kleinberg, assistant principal. It is very wonderful to see humans in this room and to experience this with y'all for the first time in a couple of years. So it's a really nice thing, and thank you all for being here. You're all here to kind of figure out what the IB is, what makes IB different, what offerings we have within our school. Before we go into detail, I want to sum it up in four key points here. We're real world. We have high expectations. We are holistic, and we try to develop thoughtful, compassionate students. Taking these one by one, our curriculum, the IB curriculum, whether it be the middle years program in grades 6 through 10 or the diploma program in grades 11 and 12, the curriculum is designed to make a real-world connection. It's contextualized to make sense to students. The classic question that is asked by students is, why do we need to know this? The curriculum answers that in and of itself. We are connecting it to real-world problems, whether that be something like sustainability or global warming or something like that, or it be something to do with economics or whatever. Our teachers work very, very diligently to make the learning meaningful, okay? One thing you probably do know about us already is that we have high expectations. I'll talk more about this a little bit later, but we have behavioral expectations. We also have academic expectations. What I don't want you to think is that when students come to us, we throw them out there and say sink or swim. We try to provide a high level of support, both academically and socially, and also in regards to their behavior. And we'll talk about those supports a little bit later. But with that high expectation comes, in general, high reward. The graduating class last year, during a pandemic of about 70 students, earned about $14 million in scholarship. That is substantial. That is more than most schools three times our size will earn. So although it is more, although the learning is deeper, although it is more rigorous, I do need you to understand that there is typically a high reward at the end of that tunnel. We are holistic, and we don't get credit for this very often because, our students who are, existing within our school in the moment just think it's kind of hard. We offer a lot of opportunities to develop the whole child, whether that be an 11-year-old or a 17, 18-year-old. Ms. Brown's going to talk to you about the community project, about services action, about the personal project. Dr. Miller will talk to you about the EE. She'll talk to you about CAS and work study and some other programs that we have. We really work very diligently, I would say, to develop the whole child, not just the academic part of the child. And lastly, we develop thoughtful, critical thinking and compassionate thinkers. We are a very diverse school. We have, last I checked, last year we had, out of our 700-ish students across both campuses, we're about 40-40-20 demographically between white, black, Hispanic. Our free reduced rate is about 40% across both campuses. We are a melting pot of students within the Jefferson County and outside of the Jefferson County area. We have, students at both campuses coming from over 50 different schools from four different counties. So we are truly a melting pot. That is a blessing. There is no curse to that. It's simply a blessing to have students from all backgrounds, socioeconomics, ethnic, racial, religious, etc., come together. And the tie that binds us is that we have students who really are engaged in the learning, and they want to have that four-year university experience. That's our goal as a school, to let that idea come to fruition. I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Brown, our middle years program coordinator, and she's going to talk about some of the things I mentioned in much more detail.
Thank you. As he said, I am Lauren Brown. It's nice to see your faces here tonight. And I am the middle years program coordinator for IB. The middle years starts in grade 6 and goes through grade 10, which is a little bit different than how we think of the American model when most middle schools are grade 6 through 8. So again, we're grade 6 through 10, and here's a little bit about our curriculum. It says here, It's a conceptual inquiry-based framework of teaching and learning. What does that mean? Here's what it means. It means that we provide concepts to our students. We provide ideas. And we open the door and let them explore that content to make that learning meaningful. It is contextualized. Every single unit of study that happens at our school has something called a grasp. And a grasp is something that provides the real world context. Teachers pose real scenarios and allow that to be the vehicle through which students learn. And it's comprehensive. Mr. Conninger mentioned that it is holistic. It is holistic in that it develops the whole child, and the middle years program is comprehensive to achieve that goal. When you're in that middle school age, you're figuring out who you are, right? You may not know what you like or what you don't like. So, we'll come back to that. So our students take lots of classes, and it exposes them to those things so that they can start to truly understand what it is that they want to pursue. And it's comprehensive to facilitate that. Service is action. Okay. Nobody's stolen my thunder yet tonight, so I get to say it for myself. How many of you, just curious, how many of you saw Dr. Miller and I this morning? Yeah, so we were, yay, cookies for you, gold stars all around. So we actually had our virtual visit via WebEx with Fultondale Elementary this morning. And I'm going to say the same thing I said to you guys, okay? I asked them in every meeting, I say, raise your hand if you've gone somewhere with your parents or on a field trip, and when it's time to go, they say, okay, clean up. We need to leave this place better than we found it. Who's ever heard that? You guys can raise your hands again. It's fine. I raise my hand and I say, I have been both the student that heard that and the teacher that said that. Take that and stretch it. Okay? An integral part of IB is not just to leave the city of Fultondale better than we found it, or the county of Jefferson, or the state of Alabama better than we found it, but what are the things that we can do locally that may have a global impact? How can we leave the world a better place than we found it? And what role does our education play in that? And that's part of it's built into our units of study. When our teachers introduce something that could have a service component, they highlight that in their unit of study. This picture was taken, you see the students have on these great blue shirts that say JCIB Serve. Pre-pandemic, there was a day in the fall and a day in the spring where students actually went out into the community. It was like a school-wide field trip, and they went to different hubs. We had Cahaba River Keepers. People went out to Turkey Creek. People went to the Hueytown Library. Some people stayed and cleaned our school. But they actually went out in the community and performed community service. Now, I will say, while that's awesome, and we hope to do that in the spring, our students are actually doing their service next Friday when we're out of school. We started that last year with some of the E-days. Students went out and did it on their own time. And guys, they will tell you that when the students wrote their reflections when they came back, I sat at my desk and cried. And I forwarded the list. I said, you guys go click and read some of this. Like, when you're having a bad day, go read how thoughtful our students are and how much care they took in planning those activities that they self-initiated, 11-year-olds, going next door to the neighbor that may be elderly and saying, can I pick up some sticks in your yard? Because we're sitting in Fultondale. We did it, I think, in February or March, right after you guys had a devastating tornado. And students went out on your streets, our students, and helped clean up debris on that day. They put the care into it. And we designate time to do that, but it's also part of our curriculum. Let's talk a little bit more about the curriculum. this is our foreign language progression. So one thing that sets us apart is that our students start acquiring a second language in the sixth grade. Language to IB is considered core. It is put right next to math and science and reading, okay? Mm-hmm. Acquiring a second language is what is going to make you marketable as a global citizen. So our students in sixth grade do something called the carousel. They actually take a little miniature class and learn a little bit about IB when they're new to the school. And then they take all three languages which we offer, which are German, French, and Spanish. At the end of sixth grade, they select the language that they're going to study throughout the rest of the IB continuum. So in seventh grade, they take that same language. And in eighth grade, they can actually take language one. So, you know, I took French in high school. I took French one when I was a freshman. Our students get to take French, German, or Spanish one in eighth grade and get to carry that credit with them to high school. So they walk in, that's one credit they walk in with as a freshman that they get at our campus. Okay. Then they continue with language in ninth, 10th, and then IB language in the DP program. Similarly, our students are accelerated in math, and beginning next year will take geometry in eighth grade, and they will carry that credit with them as well to high school. Are you picking up what I'm putting down? Our students get a jump start. They not only do they walk into high school with credits, but Dr. Miller's going to tell you about how they walk into college with lots of credits because we put them on that path, okay? So walking in or walking out of eighth grade with a credit, then algebra one and ninth, algebra two and tenth. And then it says pre-calculus and calculus, but I think Dr. Miller is going to talk to you a little bit more because the IB names for the maths are a little bit wonky. So just to recap before I hand this off, I said on the first slide that our curriculum is comprehensive. So let's review what classes all JCIB sixth graders, which I'm making an assumption here that most of you are in fifth grade looking at coming in for sixth, but certainly after we take two, you take language A and language B, so English, and then your foreign language choice, mathematics, which is accelerated advanced, science, individuals and societies is the fun name that IB gives to what we in the U.S. call social studies. Design, which is an awesome, basically a problem-solving class, okay? Students have problems and try to develop real-world solutions. Design is one of those things where students work on something. We talked about the IB learner profile, but there's something else called ATL skills. Five skill clusters, okay? And I hope that when you were listening to Ms. Lightsey list those IB learner profile traits, you thought, anybody that's those is just going to be successful. They're going to be a good student, and they're going to be successful in life. Same thing for these ATL skills, okay? The clusters for that are communication, social skills, self-management skills, research, and thinking skills. If you possess those, you're going to be successful. And that design class really works those. All of our students have to have some exposure to the arts. At our middle school, we have choir, band, and visual art. And then, of course, PE. Other cool special IB things. I've already talked about service as action. In ninth grade, our students undertake the community project, which is a service project that they focus on in their ninth grade year. And in their 10th grade year, they do the personal project. The personal project is just that. It's a really cool thing. Students set a goal for themselves, something that they want to learn, and they spend a minimum of 25 hours, but probably a lot more, right, Connor? A lot more than 25 developing it. By the way, this is Connor in the back running our camera. I got to know him because he did a technology-based personal project, and I talked with him a lot about that last year, and when it came to needing a student or somebody to help us with technology for these meetings, I knew he was the one to call because I had watched the work that he put in and watched his growth and knew what his skills were related to that. So the personal project is awesome. We actually have a short video to watch on the personal project where you'll get to see some of the things our students have done in the past.
Sun is shining in the sky, there ain't a cloud in sight. It's so raining, everybody's in bed, and don't you look, it's a beautiful day. Hey, we'll be down the avenue, see how the sun shines bright in the city. On the streets where once was bed, it's the blue. Tired of living in the day. Hey, hey. This blue sky, please tell us why. What a bad way for so long. Where did we go wrong? Mr. Blue Sky, please tell us why. What a bad way for so long. Where did we go wrong?
Just keep going. Find that thing you love because it's tough work. But I think if you can find that thing that really gives you joy, that'll be it. As a 3-year-old said, comedy, stand up, and act your truth. It's tough work, but it's going to get it even better. Good luck.
Hey, you put a pretty face. Welcome to the funeral.
So that makes all of us just tap our feet and toes. These students graduated this past spring, so this was 2 years ago when they did their projects. And as Mr. Cloninger will tell you, you saw students, Cole at the end, who was standing up, looked like he was on a soapbox. He was doing stand-up comedy. And this was a student that I never heard speak before. In class, he would contribute, but you really had to sort of pry it out of him. And he developed a 15-minute routine and stood out in the hall and performed for everybody and anybody who was walking by. The personal project is just such an amazing thing to watch. The skills, the talent that students develop as a result of this, it really is inspiring. And the video was made by one of our graduates from that year, so that would have been 2019, who's gone on and he's making more and more films even now. So I love that. Anyway,
oh, hello. Look again.
Ms. Brown is our technical guru. Okay, so the diploma program. Here we go. This is the last 2 years for high school. But we start in sixth grade. What we start doing in sixth grade is going to carry through 12th grade. Everything that you would do in a regular high school, we are doing at IB. So you have to take career prep, health, PE at a regular high school in order to graduate. We do that. We do more. We go deeper into topics, longer study terms. It's just there is more to it. So when we say grow more, know more, that's part of what we're talking about. There were 8 groups in the middle years program. There are 6 in the diploma program. English, foreign language, I'm just using quick words, social studies, math, science, and then the electives. And the students take one course from each of these across the 2 years so that they are able to sit for exams at the end and work towards the diploma for IB. The electives, we have 5 different electives. Currently we have chemistry, geography, social and cultural anthropology, psychology, and environmental systems and society. So there's a wide range of things that students can study and find what it is that they're interested in. We talked about international mindedness as being at the core. These are curricular cores. We have a class called Theory of Knowledge, which is a two-year course, which again is looking at the big picture. It's similar to a philosophy course. We ask big questions and try to come up with some answers to them, but it's how do we know what we know and why do we think what we think? This is the course that when students come back and talk about, this is the one that they are the most effusive about. This is the one they really enjoy because there's not really anything else like it. It connects all of the courses, history to math, English to science, and asking those big questions. The extended essay is the thing that makes some people take a step back. This is a research paper of sorts. It's 4,000 words. So if you're doing the math in your head, 4,000 words is about 20 pages. This is a significant paper that our students start about now in their junior year, and they will turn in the paper early fall of their senior year. They have a mentor who works with them, but they get to choose their topic. They study something that they're really interested in and they want to know more about. Like the personal project, IB wants student choice and student voice. They want to know that you're really interested in what you're doing, and so they're going to give you leeway to investigate. We have incremental deadlines for this, so it's not like we would just wake all the seniors up one Tuesday morning and say, where's that 20-page paper we told you about? We work with them throughout so that they've got the preparation and skills, starting from sixth grade, on how to do such an advanced paper. And what this does is it prepares students when they get, along with everything else, when they get to college. IB students in college are not typically going to pull their hair out when they get to an English class or a history class or any class. And they're told on Monday morning that when they come back on Wednesday, they've got to have a 5-page paper because they've written lots of those. They are comfortable. They don't panic. Other students who may have only written a few 5-page papers in their high school career may not feel as confident in such a setting. And so the stress is much reduced for IB students in college. Ms. Brown talked about the fact that they've got credits going into high school, and yes, they do have credits going into college as well, because we take, starting in ninth grade, AP courses, and then we have IB courses starting in 11th grade. A lot of the IB students, when they get to college, are not considered freshmen based on their hours. They come in with enough hours to be first and sometimes second semester sophomores. And that's a big deal because what that means is that you've got the ability sometimes to graduate early or to study at a higher level than you might have. You don't have to do those 100 level courses. And I'm not sure that we said it at the beginning, but 100% of our students are accepted to 4-year college. This is what we're working towards, everybody. And that's unusual. We're not saying that's the only thing or that's the best thing. But that's what our students are working towards. And so you've got a lot of kids working in the same direction. When Ms. Lightsey talks about the fact that we don't have a lot of discipline problems, part of that is because we're very focused on learning. And most of the people who are with us at school want to be there for learning. And so that's a different type of environment. The last part of the core is CAS, Creativity, Activity, and Service. Again, we started this in sixth grade. We keep doing it all the way through 12th grade. We do this because it makes the world a better place. We also do it because it makes the student more attractive to colleges. Colleges, the team at IB, IB in the world, we don't want students who just have their nose in a book 24 hours a day. We want well-rounded individuals who like to do and are interested in a variety of things. And so that's what CAS is. One of the things that we allow, or that our students get to do, as juniors, on Wednesday afternoons, they are dismissed at 11 o'clock so that they can go into the community and volunteer at a place for a semester or for a year to explore what they think they want to do in college or for their career. So we have students who are working at vet clinics. We have students who are working at architecture firms. We have students who are volunteering at law offices, in labs, at doctor offices, a whole variety of places so that they can get an idea. I think I want to be a pediatrician, but I've never been around children who weren't all happy and friendly, so it might be a good idea to find out if I like children who don't feel good all the time. And in high school, I found out I wasn't crazy about that, and so it was a good idea that I wouldn't work in a lab later. I ended up here. Anyway, it's one of those things that it gives you a chance to figure out what you want to do maybe before you get there, and that can save time, money, and help you focus or say, oh, that's not what I really thought it was. Let's try something different. And so those are at the core of the DP in terms of some of that stuff that we do above and beyond what you might get at a regular high school in terms of curricular and classwork. And now Mr. Cloninger is going to talk about some of those supports.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
You did a great job. I have nothing else to say.
But you do.
You know, it's fair to say that our school requires more as a student. I think we've made that abundantly clear. And like I said at the beginning, it's also fair to say that we give students multiple opportunities and multiple supports to make that adjustment from their base school, where there's a variety of expectations, to our school, where there's a singular focusing goal. Our goal when we get a student is to keep them, period, the end. If we get them in 6th grade, our goal is to keep them through 12th. If we get them in 11th grade, is to keep them through 12th. Now, as you probably already know, that's not always the case. We lose students throughout each year for a variety of reasons. We have one whose family moved to South Carolina. That's a loss that we can't help. We lose students who fail to meet some of these requirements from time to time. But before we ever get to that point, we try to intervene, have, you know, a full-fledged intervention and say, what's the problem? How can we address it? How can we fix this long-term? Ms. Lyons said we don't have a lot of extreme behaviors, and that is true. We don't have, you know, a lot of disciplinary issues, which is great for a variety of reasons. It makes my job a lot easier as an assistant principal, for sure. But what do we do if we have students who do not maintain exemplary behavior? We kick them out? That's a possibility if it's a lack of exemplary behavior time after time after time, okay? Or there's, you know, say one severe instance of, you know, say a class 3 behavior or something like that. Before we get to that point, though, we have these supports. We have counseling initiatives like any other school. We try to intervene with that student and address that student's social, emotional, health, or needs. We have PBIS, which is a positive behavior and intervention program, which rewards students for doing the right thing. So it's proactively addressing good behavior instead of reactively addressing bad behavior. We do have behavior probation, just like we have academic probation. So if students are making poor choices, we put them with a liaison. We may put them with a behavior plan and help them keep track of how their decisions are impacting their own learning, etc. And lastly, we also have a variety of different mentor groups. We have, you know, ambassadors, freshman mentors, new student mentors that are designed to help students acclimate to the new school, acclimate to the expectations, because we realize that it's certainly difficult to leave the school that you've always went to or that you have friends at and come to this new place. And sometimes when kids go to a new place, it's almost natural instinct to kind of blow your chest out a little bit and you know, I guess claim your territory. We try to negate that through offering students a very natural integration into our school. The issue we have more so out of the two are academic issues. Our goal here is for every student to maintain at least a 3.0 weighted GPA. Weighted simply means that, you know, you've probably heard of a 4.0. Our students, because they're taking advanced classes, that AE actually equals 5. So they can get a 5.0. So that really helps them a lot to maintain this 3.0. If students fall below that 3.0, they're not automatically kicked out. We're not saying 2.8, gone. What we're saying is that 2.8, all right, let's fix this before it turns into a 2.4. And once again, we have academic liaisons, individuals, adults in the building whose purpose is to say to that child, tell us how you got here. Most of the time they don't know. So then we play investigator and say, okay, do you have good study skills? Do you do your homework? What's it like, what's your attention span like in the classroom? And we make plans with them and go through, you know, step by step what they need to do. We have academic probation. They get that scary letter in the mail that says you're on academic probation. Here are the next steps. They have access to teachers before, during, and after school. We have time built in during the day where students have the flexibility to go get assistance, and teachers have the flexibility to assist and remediate students as needed. And lastly, we have, once again, a variety of student-led groups who are designed to be peer tutors, math tutors, writing tutors, so on and so forth. So, sum all that up, students are not perfect. The adults in the building certainly are not perfect. So what we try to do is when we see issues academically or behavior, is to fix them. Give kids chances to make that adjustment to a new school. I'm not going to read what's in white here, but I will read the two main topics here, which is how can my child benefit from JCIB? Our goal here is to instill knowledge into that child and also to change their attitude to learning. And so knowledge, Dr. Miller and Ms. Brown have done a phenomenal job of talking about the knowledge aspect. Haven't talked a whole lot about that, about the attitude aspect. Students who are accepted into JCIB, regardless of if they're in the sixth grade or in the 11th grade, they use that same rubric, that same application process to apply to us. Application processes do not always tell the student's attitude towards learning. It does tell their aptitude generally, how smart are they? We take students who are at a wide range of levels. Not every student at JCIB is, quote, gifted. Many of our students are gifted, say, in math, but not in reading. They can do calculus, but they can't analyze a poem, or vice versa. Our goal here with attitudes is to change their perception of what school is and what learning is, and, really to make them understand that learning is not this finite thing. It doesn't stop when you hit 12th grade. It's this continuous thing that you consistently do. We want our students not to use cliches, but to be lifelong learners and to be a part of that collaborative environment, which is JCIB. For the sake of time, I'm going to skip this video because I know we're running a little bit behind here. But basically, these students are saying JCIB changed my life because it's really good. And so that's all you need to know. Ms. Lice is going to talk about the application process, which is what you want to know. Or hopefully you want to know.
So you've got the meat of it. You got all the stuff about what it is, who we are, the expectations, the goals of the students, our goals for them, and hopefully your goals and our goals match up. The application process is going to open up 1st of December. It's not a complicated process. It can be if you try to piecemeal it, but if you'll sort of just, if you're in district, if you're in Jefferson County, it should be a smooth process. So it begins on December 1st when the application goes live or becomes available on the district website. You can go there, you'll be able to see it, download the application. Once you do that, you simply complete the parent portion, which is the demographics, where you live, the age of the child, birth date, all of that general information. Student has a portion, which is an essay, short, not two paragraphs is all it's going to be, and it's about those IB learner profiles, traits that we were talking about. And then some answering some questions. Not complicated, shouldn't take more than 10 minutes, honestly, for both of them. Once you get your part, you need to let the counselor know at your school that your child is applying, because the counselor has a lot of material to get together. They're going to have to pull grades because we check GPA. They're going to pull attendance history, because we look at attendance, because if the student's not coming to school regularly, IB is hard to, it's hard to miss out on. Our kids come to school sick too often because they don't want to miss, because they feel like they're going to get behind. I mean, we truly need them to stay home when they're sick. I appreciate people not wanting to miss it, but illness is, you know, you gotta be careful with that. So, you know, that if they will, if the counselor provides all of these things, your job was done here. You were done. The counselor's going to provide all the things, standardized tests, attendance, all that stuff. They're going to put a packet together. They're going to put all the students from the school, wherever your child is. Now, we may get a package full of 8 or 10 applications from that school alone. That's a really wonderful thing when I see it come in the door like that, because I know it's all together in a package and we're good to go. It's harder when a parent sends their part and then I'm creating a folder and waiting on the counselor to send their part, and they may not, and then I'm hunting it, and then I'm having to call, and then it can turn into a bit of a nightmare. I will call, but I don't always find. So I put that effort in, but it doesn't always turn out really the way you'd want it to. So that's that process. Simple enough. If you're out of district, it's still not difficult as long as you have someone at the school that will work with you. So that's typically going to be your counselor. The financial obligation. I always try to think I can say this better than I did the last time, because I always confuse people. If your child is zoned to go to a Jefferson County school, there is no tuition. If you're zoned for Fultondale or Gardendale or Rudd or Center Point, those are all Jefferson County schools. There's no tuition. If your child is zoned for a school that is not Jefferson County, but it may be inside Jefferson County, like Midfield, Vestavia is in Jefferson County, part of it, Hoover's in Jefferson County, part of it, Bessemer, those areas have their own school district, and children are zoned for that school district. There's a $2,200 tuition for the year per child. So, and there's even now, on the Jefferson County website under Student Services, there's even a little map where you could put in your address and it tells you you're zoned for here, or you're not zoned for Jefferson County. So if you have questions about that, that's a good resource to go to. But if you're Homewood, Vestavia, Hoover, Birmingham, Bessemer, Midfield, Fairfield, that's a tuition situation for us. Our school's free. The application closes Valentine's, so February 14th, 2022. That's when it has to be to us. We don't take them after that. So from December 1st through the end, please don't wait till then to hand something to the counselor, because it may take her, I mean, you never know what's going on in a counselor's world. It may take her a week to get it. So please do this all on the front end. Go ahead and get it done. Give it to her so she's got 2 or 3 weeks to put everything together and get it to us by February 14th deadline. And that's it. We did it. How much time did we take? I'm competitive.
50 minutes.
50 minutes.
That's excellent.
Perfect.
Okay, that's good. All right, so I'm sure we didn't answer some things. And the two things I know right away that we didn't. People always wonder about transportation. We have sites throughout the district where the children converge on that area, load the bus, we take them to school, then we take them back to that same spot, parents pick them up. We don't go door-to-door picking students up. You go to those locations. They're all over the county. We even have one in Hoover there at that guitar center that takes care of some kids that are on the far side, not the McCalla kids, not the McDoor kids, but that's up close to Hoover there. Pinson, all over the place, just they're everywhere. So that's the transportation process. Can my child ride a bus to this location because I work here and I can pick them up there at Irondale even though I live in Adamsville? Yes, it's just you have to do that. That's your routine. They can't jump on the bus every other day. It's not the max bus. And the drivers, it would drive us crazy. And we're accountable for them. We need to know who's on the bus, when and where, for a lot of reasons. But if you set up a system where, yes, they're going to ride from home. I'm going to pick them up in Irondale. We do that. We want to do what we can to help. Sports is the other question that we get a lot of. If your student, and Mr. Clonerty usually says this, so I'm going to steal his words. If your student is a three-sport student, I mean, they want to play football, basketball, baseball, they even want to play a little bowling and soccer, that's probably not going to work with IB. Our kids have more core than other students do. There's not that as much space in there to do all of those things. But if they want to play a sport, it's no problem. If they're wanting to play four or five sports, they're probably going for a sports scholarship instead of an academic scholarship. So you have to sort of make a choice at some point about what's best for your child and what they really want to pursue and put all their energy into. So, you know, that's the sports. And you may have this other question, another one. You may have heard that we will have a school here in Fultondale one day. And from everything that I know and have been told, that is true. When the Fultondale High School is built, which is still going to be probably 18 months away, 2 years, I'm not sure. It takes usually a good long while. Once that's built and those kids get to come from Warrior back to their normal school, they say that they will begin on building a JCIB campus where the old Fultondale campus was, the high school. So we'll be very close to them, but it'll be our own school. When we are that school, I can almost promise you, we will never have basketball, football, baseball, the big three. I mean, baseball could come somewhere, but the thing is, you got to realize, at the high school, we only have about 25 kids out of 350 who play a sport. That doesn't make much of a team. You know what I'm saying? That's 20 kids, 10 of them are playing baseball, and the other 15 are football and bowling. So our kids just aren't that. Sports is not their big thing. But we will have things that we have now. Our kids are real big into cross country. I think we're going to have mountain biking. You know, we've got a bowling team that's really good. It's always surprising to people, and they always laugh, but I mean, they can bowl. Tennis, we got some swimmers right now. It's probably been golf. I don't remember golf, but probably has.
It's golf right now.
So if you think about those things that I'm saying, those are those lifelong sports. Like, how many people play football when they're 55? How many people golf? How many people bowl? So what we're trying to do, that's sort of perfect in line with what we're asking kids, is you're always looking at balance in your life. That's part of it. A lifelong sport is much healthier for you, quite frankly, in the long run. But I think those are the...
Yeah, the sports situation, one thing you didn't mention was that at the middle school level, they have to play sports at their base school. And that has to be worked out between the parent, the student, and the coach of that school. You know, for example, that coach would have to allow them, you know, say to practice late every day. Some coaches will allow that, some won't. And they'd have to get special transportation if they needed to get there a little bit quicker than what the bus or the bus could get them there, or close to it anyway. At the high school level, you play with Shades Valley High School. So when she said we have 25 athletes, that's 9-12. We have less than that at the middle school.
Probably only about 4 or 5 at the middle school, yeah.
Just because logistically, it's just a little bit difficult, you know.
It can be done.
It takes a large amount of commitment and following that schedule quite well.
If you get the coaches love our kids because they're really generally very conscientious and are, you know, take what they do seriously and do it well. I don't think that we've had a situation where a coach wouldn't work with one of our kids. We've had go back to Clay Chalkville to play softball, McAdory for football, Minor for football. So it's just a matter of getting organized.
So even if it is one of the big three, they could play at their home school?
Not when we're one school. Not when we're on our own campus. Okay. Once we become our own campus, once we're not attached to another high school, they won't be able to do that Tim Tebow kind of law where, you know, that's the home. If you're homeschooled, but you can go play where you're zoned, they won't be able to do leave that high school. That's those high school sports rules are very, very serious.
This is the time of year where high school teams forfeit all their wins because they've been using an ineligible player.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it would make sense to someone who didn't know the AHSAA rules if we're on one campus, there's Fultondale High School.
Yeah.
You know, hop in a skip, they're practicing football. I don't like to do that.
Yeah.
You can't do that because we're on our own.
Yeah. And I mean, that's where what Dr. Miller said earlier is that there is a choice to be made. There's so many pathways to success. IB is just one pathway. There are many other ways to get your child where they want to go. If this is the pathway, if academics and a sport is something that they really want to do, that's a very doable thing. But if your child is thinking college football, playing college football, the high school's probably not good. Our high school probably would not be the spot when we're not attached to Shades Valley. Yes, ma'am.
It might not be about sports, but my daughter goes to school in Atlanta, and if she did go
No, you would. You're with us full time in Pleasant Grove, 6 through 8.
Okay, and then
wherever the Fultondale location is,
Kmart.
It's actually Gardendale.
Okay.
Yes. Have to get her there and pick her up at that same spot. And usually, you know, 6:45 is our earliest pickup usually, and I think 4:15, 4:20 is our latest drop-off now, which is probably Pinson, I think.
Pinson's at 4.
4?
Yeah.
There's another one.
But, you know, you can also do Carline as well. So, you know, if you live in Hueytown, you know, or if you live in Fultondale, but you work somewhere where it's easier to get you through Carline, you can certainly do that.
Yes, sir.
We're not here for the elementary part. We're here for the middle school part.
Uh-huh. Yeah, so, we don't have elementary. We're just 6 through 8. And
we're
then
here for the 8th grade.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah.
That's middle school.
Yeah. Switzerland?
Yes.
Okay.
It's Pleasant Grove.
Okay, so she'll be going to the 9th grade.
Oh, she'll be going to Shades Valley.
Yes.
Yeah. So we have to go to a different meeting? Or just
same meeting.
Okay.
This is us.
But you can come to the open house, which is November 30th.
At Shades Valley.
That's all that
I said. I would encourage you all to go to the prospective student open houses so you can see the buildings, walk the hallways. Should have some teachers there, and you can kind of get a feel for it. December 6th at the middle school.
Yeah.
December 7th at the middle school.
December 7th.
At the middle school.
That's the middle school.
You want November 3rd?
Yeah, you want to do
November 3rd. We got 2.
Go ahead. I have about 3
left. Go for it.
So my first question is, what's the turnaround time
when
you apply?
You'll know. I didn't say that. None of y'all told me that either.
Sorry.
They're
going to
ask it.
Yeah. They're in by the 14th of February. We score, and we usually get, on a normal year, about between 500 and 600 applications. There's a committee that includes more than just us, but we score them, and we have the answer, either accepted or not, in the mail the Friday before spring break. So you know at that point, yes, you have been accepted. No, you have not. Please try again if you want to. But that goes out the Friday before spring break. I think I did it a week early last year, but I just can't remember.
I think I did, but I can't promise that.
We were moving. But that's the time. That's the turnaround. So you know by then.
And if you do it the Friday before spring break, when parents call,
we're not there.
No one's there to answer the phone.
They know.
So.
We admitted it, though. Makes us better people.
My next question was from Lauren.
Yeah.
Okay. So you talked about the foreign languages in the 6th grade, like they take like 3. So what if you have someone that's kind of to you all from the 7th grade?
Sure. That's a great question. I can answer that for 7th and for 9th. So right now for 9th grade, if they have taken language at their middle school, we can sometimes put them in at 2, whatever, French, German, Spanish, 2. If they don't have foreign language experience prior, right now the only thing that we have level 1 is German. So they would go into, she would go into German, and that would be her language.
And for 7th grade, it would be
whatever
one of those 3.
They only take 9 weeks of it. So in sixth grade on that carousel. So it's not in depth, so they're not behind.
That was two. Got one more.
Yes, you got one more.
Oh, the application. So when we complete our part of the application, is it best for us to wait till the counselor kind of, or should we go ahead and submit our part?
I would take your part, make a copy, keep your own, take it to the counselor, let her know that she needs to add her piece to it, and let her send it to us. Are you in Jefferson County right now, school?
Yes.
Yes.
It would also, in my opinion, be wise if you ask that counselor to send you a courtesy email when she sent it out to us.
Yeah, I mean, you can send your part to us. I'll create, or someone will create a file. We'll take your part in, and when the other comes in from the school, we'll match it up. It's just worrisome that sometimes they don't. And again, I do reach out. I don't just ignore it if it's not complete. I reach out and say, I'm looking for this. I still haven't got it. But I can't just dog them for it. You know, that's not okay. Yes, ma'am. Oh, I'm sorry. I jumped him. He was already.
Oh, wait.
Somebody.
Okay.
He's
been. Well, I know that you were talking about the application. They had to be submitted by spring break. So the children don't start until not 2022, but
2022. Fall. The next school year.
Yeah, so the application is submitted by February 14th, and you'll find out that week of spring break.
And then
they'll
start
the next
school year.
Yeah, in August.
So we're not coming from a county or a city school. We're coming from a private school.
Yeah, we get a bunch of that.
So we just go through the same application procedure. He's already taken foreign languages as well. So.
Yes.
And, we ask about, we'll get the grades.
So does she have to pick another language, or she just keep that baseline?
She keep going.
Depends on what she wants to do.
Yeah.
So if you want to take a change, like you're taking French right now, and you're like, let's try something different. I'll do German.
German.
You can do German for 4 years.
And this is only my second year. Yeah, switch jobs in a pandemic. It's awesome. but I was amazed last year at the number of applications that we had coming from outside the district. So I will speak and say I think that those counselors at those institutions are familiar with us and have been through that process with us.
A quick question with the tuition part. Is it going to go up or down, or what? Is it base pay?
I talked to
Mr. Miller, sent me an email back a couple months ago. You don't remember.
It's been that way for the last 6 years.
It's been that way.
She said she didn't know the time. So.
I always say that because I don't have control over it.
Right.
But I've been in the office for 12 years, and it's been $2,200 for 12 years.
Okay,
got it. Your tuition hasn't changed, and bus routes haven't changed.
So what is the price of the bus route?
Do what?
You said bus route, so we have to pay for buses.
No.
Just the pickup locations and times. I mean, the times have changed a little bit, but those spots have not changed.
All right.
You just pick the closest location to you.
My son's teacher was going to write a letter of recommendation. She was wondering what, you know, she needed to cover.
So in that application, when you download it, there are forms. You have to get a teacher recommendation from two teachers, science and English, or math and
science. Math and science, and English and history.
What they said. There'll be two of those, and then the counselor will also complete a form as well. So I would tell her not to write anything yet because she can write it on that.
Yes, sir. Actually, this gentleman asked the question because we have a child who's been a virtual learner, so at the school.
Yeah, we had that question. And the question last week was that the people, if you're in J.C. Bow, are you working through Jefferson County Virtual Academy?
No.
Actually, we're in one of the back
end. Okay. Mm-hmm. The thing with that is that if the people know your child, then they'll be able to complete, you know, they'll be able to complete a recommendation. If they don't, if there's not a relationship, that's going to be a little difficult. And I would recommend going back to the previous school where the child maybe was with a teacher throughout the day that could give the information that we're asking for. I would do that, and we would take that from a previous year.
Okay.
Okay.
A previous year or a previous teacher?
Previous teacher. mean, it's like going back to first grade might be a little tough. Yeah. But and the way it works, for the things that we're asking for, we use a holistic scoring rubric. So for the things that we're asking for, you know, standardized tests, grades, attendance, teacher recommendations, discipline reports, for all of those things we ask for, they receive a score on the rubric. So if they come in and there's not teacher recommendation, well, there might be 4 points that aren't earned. If pieces are missing, we can't change the rubric, is what I'm saying. Or then it's not fair anymore. So that's why it's really important to get it done early so that everything's provided. And if there are questions or concerns about how do I get this, you can contact us and we'll work through it with you.
Right. November 30 for the high school, December 7th for the middle school.
Small. December 7th.
At the Pleasant Grove campus.
Okay. I have a fourth grader, you know, I'm kind of planning ahead here, so I'm like really looking forward to move and stuff. Would it be like pointless for me to come to this one this year, considering it'll be a whole other school year?
I would come on and just take a look. I mean, we're there for about 45 minutes. We just try to get the teachers to come out, open up their rooms, let you guys just sort of walk around. We used to do during school when kids are there. The time has changed where mass groups of people coming into a school building are not, it's not really a great thing. It's just not ideal. So we do the evening time just so you can see the campus because it's ugly. And you need to know. You need to know
how out there in the world.
I mean, it is. It's
welcome,
like a,
YouTubers.
It's not a pretty campus. It's an old campus. It's about 60 years old. If you compare it to Shades Valley, even if you compare it to this, it's one of those old schools. Been there 60 years, and you know you're gonna drive up and you're gonna go, ooh, the school my child is zoned for is just beautiful. And, am I going to send them over here to the 60-year-old building? And you're going to think about it. I'm just being real with you. You're going to think about that for a minute. But it's the book and the cover, you know. Do you judge the book by the cover, or do you get into the book?
Yeah, Ms. Leslie, yeah. One thing we forgot to say, and it's important, was, 2 weeks ago, the U.S. Newsweek report came out.
Yeah, we didn't forget that.
And our middle school was ranked the number one middle school in the state of Alabama, right? Yeah. So do you judge a school's quality on the paint, on the really high, awesome ceilings?
Or lack thereof?
Or lack thereof.
I mean, we do take good care. It is clean. So I think that's what I've taught in my whole life is a school that looks just like that. So I'm perfectly at home there. And our staff does a wonderful job. It is a clean campus, well kept. I'm not ashamed to be there at all. But if you're comparing it to what some other schools are, you're going to go, ouch. But it's come in and look and talk to parents. Yeah, talk to the parents. It's old, but it's clean, and it's very, it makes you feel good when you're there with kids, watching them do what they do, watching the teachers do what they do with the kids who want to learn. It's very, it's just rewarding to be part of it. Yes, sir.
Before we moved our son to private school, we're zoned for Pleasant Grove. Mm-hmm. And he was at Pleasant Grove Elementary School, and he actually tested for the gifted program. Mm-hmm. When we submit the application, do we need to, get that?
Yeah, you do. But we may not.
Where would we go about getting that?
So I would contact the former school, because if he didn't go over, did he leave fifth grade or sixth grade?
He's actually in the sixth now.
Okay, so they're still going to have his.
Oh, yeah, he tested in the third.
Okay, but they're probably, since he's in a private school, most likely Pleasant Grove Elementary still has his cumulative records. All you have to do is ask for that gifted plan, and you can attach that to the application, and that'll help us in what we do. You don't have to be gifted to be admitted, but a lot of gifted students do apply.
Thank you.
Any other questions? And we have a parent here. Raise your hand, parent. And so it's not an attractive school, but is it not clean?
It's very clean.
Yes.
It's
painted.
Yeah. The only drawback that gym's not air conditioned. Mr. Van Abel will run you.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. He will.
That's the only thing. Yeah, the campus is very well taken.
Right now he's running them up and down the field playing lacrosse.
Yeah, they're playing lacrosse.
And there's written PE tests, which blew me away.
Yeah, it's a subject. It's not just an activity.
It is holistic and comprehensive.
PE
is on the same level.
When the World Games come to Birmingham, most of our students would know the games because they play them at PE.
They play.
Right.
I've never seen dodgeball once.
Don't call him
my favorite game.
Yeah, don't call him coach. He's not.
Yeah,
he's not a coach.
He's not. He will tell you. The coach will tell you. He's not a coach. I'm Mr. Van Abel.
He's a teacher.
And I teach. So it's a mentality. And if the kids get right into it, do they like having assignments that they get graded on in PE? It's a shift in thinking. But once they make that shift, it's not hard. It's just a matter of getting into a groove of doing it. And they do. They really do. So we've kept you a long time. But
we got one more last one.
Do you have a number of students that you'll accept?
We have, that's always a tough one. With our teaching units, we usually have around 120 kids per grade level. It goes down when they go up into the higher grades, but at the middle school campus, with the amount of teachers, we can handle about 120. And you can apply, we always have some spot. Last year we didn't in ninth grade, but we took more anyway. which our teacher, ninth grade teachers aren't our fans right now because of it. But we took over nearly 124. So once you're in the program, you're in the program. You don't have to reapply to go to ninth grade. The only reason that if you don't go to ninth grade, it's because something's wrong. It's not working for you. You're struggling too much, not making the grades. You know, it's just not a good fit, and that happens. That's okay. It's not a failure. That's just, it's not a fit. Happens sometimes, and children move on. But, you know, once you're ours, we want you. We want to keep you. We want to keep you through graduation. So that's the goal, and we'll work with you to make that happen. Anybody else? We got them all? Yes, sir.
When you say that, so when the new campus comes, are you still planning on the same matrix?
Yes, I would say more. I mean, it's worked really well so far. Last year was our first. Was last year the first completely all the way through?
Eighth graders.
Yeah, they started. They were our first group of kids, and they graduated last year. They did really well. You can tell a difference when they start down in the 6th, 7th, 8th. You can tell that they've been a little more prepared, which is the whole goal anyway, is to prepare for the DP program. So it'll remain the same. Yeah. All right. Well, it's been really has been a pleasure. We were so happy to see people.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.